name is Major Cyril Saltibus, and welcome to Celebrating 95, our epic cadeting journey. The St. Lucia Cadet Corps is a paramilitary youth organization sponsored by the Government of St. Lucia through the Ministry of Education. Participating in both paramilitary and community activities, cadeting began in England in 1859 to repel a potential French invasion. It continued through World War II with social workers like Miss Octavia Hill recognizing its value for boys' development. The movement was introduced to St. Lucia on July 13, 1929, with an establishment of a unit at St. Mary's College aimed at promoting discipline and character building. Initially focused on drill, route march, and national parades, the St. Lucia Cadet Corps has evolved significantly over the years and now operates through Act No. 23 of 2005 within 22 secondary schools on Ireland. We aim to develop qualities of good and outstanding citizens in our members, while at the same time encouraging a spirit of service to country and the local community through our motto of leadership, service, and discipline. Welcome once again to Celebrating 95, an insight into the St. Lucia Cadet Corps. Good evening, St. Lucia. Good evening to all our friends in the diaspora, parents, cadets, everyone in St. Lucia. Welcome to another series in our Celebrating 95 tour till the July 13th celebration. Tonight, my guest, I think we all know him, Lieutenant Colonel Lucius Lake, Deputy Commandant of the St. Lucia Cadet Corps, is going to continue that journey as we attempt to educate cadets, to spread the good news of cadeting throughout St. Lucia and beyond our shores. Good evening, Lieutenant Commander. How are you tonight?
I'm good. Good evening, all. Good evening, all viewing.
Commander, tell us a little bit about who really is Lieutenant Colonel Lucius Lake.
It's a long list. I'll make it very short. Founder member of the Entrepot Secondary School Cadet Unit. That's in the early 80s. Moving on to that. I have been a cadet all my life. Whereas I may be seen in a different light as a former police officer, having recently retired, I spent more times with the cadets doing everything under the sun. The good, the bad, and the not so good. So cadeting has been my life, even to this day. Whereas I spent over 30 years with the police, I have that longer link with the cadets. Most of my close and personal friends are either cadet officers or police officers. So my life has just been that way forever.
Good, good, good. What really inspired you to become a member of the St. Lucia Cadet Corps? What was that moment in time? Who was that individual, or what happened in your life that said, hey, I want to be a cadet?
I used to be in the Scouts, the 12th St. Lucia Scout Troop, which was the Anglican Scout Troop. And I had done all I had to do. With Brian Richards, Little Charles, were the persons who had helped out with one Mr. Seeley. And I wanted a little more. Then the cadets started showing themselves and what they could do, the weapon training, the discipline, all it was. And that I was sold from then. There was nothing more to do in that regard other than go to the authorities and have them start the Entrepot Junior Secondary School to start the cadet unit there. So the foundation started there, and history will dictate the pace there forward. But the scouts did not meet every aspect of what I wanted. Cadet did it.
Cadet did it. Good, good, good. I asked, on my last show, I asked the commandant of the St. Lucia Cadet Corps to share some milestones, takeaways of, milestones into St. Lucia Cadet Corps. You're the shadowing commandant. You're the deputy commandant. What are some of your takeaways, your milestones that you can, that you can put your hands on and say, yo, those are memorable in my life as a young cadet growing up?
I will start with what we use right now. With the assistance of Major Trevor Alfred and Lieutenant Commander Robert Thomas, These persons assisted me in using all the consent forms, all used for every cadet activity now going forward, including the risk assessment. These core persons assisted me in getting that done. We worked on it. Notwithstanding the times of the document called Genesis and all what we did, the training programs and all, this is what we use right now, these training forms and notices that we use with the risk assessments and all. That is the biggest takeaway. It guides persons, cadet officers, who want to have activities on the way to get it done. So you're not trying to reinvent the wheel. It's an established protocol that without these forms being brought in, your event might not take place. So there are others, but this one brings to mind what is being used by the entire establishment right now for any cadet activity.
You are one, I think, of, not, I wouldn't say, oldest cadets right now? Or?
Yes.
Good. Over time, how have the mission and vision of Lucia Cadet, you know, and what expect, you know, to become of this great organization over time?
We have had ups and downs over the years. There are times we had, in time of Cobert Phillips, Commissioner of Police, we had an excellent relation with the police force. That went for its own phase and up and down. We are right now trying to formalize a lot of what we had as gentlemen's agreements. Mm-hmm. It brings to line the level of voluntarism. Every cadet you see is a volunteer. He gets no pay. And you, as head of the volunteer corps, you know what that speaks of.
Yes, yes. Selfless giving. Yes.
It goes beyond. And I want to say goodnight to the cadet officers and the parents who listen now. Volunteer to the point that some of our cadet officers aid and assist the cadets not only on cadet activities, in normal life. Bus fare, lunch, supper, anything they can to assist the betterment or the well-being of cadets. It goes to some instances where some of these cadet officers come and they say they never signed up for some of the issues that some of these cadets have at home. So it goes beyond. It's once you get that cadet bug in you, it's you know, it's almost impossible to get it out. On your last show, cadets called in and said that they never resigned. They never left.
Yes.
They left Ireland, and that is what you get from cadets to the point. Talk about Danny Samuel. I mean, I don't want to miss out anybody. Sion Ferrari, a lot of persons in. I don't want to miss out on other persons, but these are some of the names which come to hand, which when you have cadet dialogue with them. Chris Mathias, Box, Eddie Hazel. I mean,
so to the end of our program, nearing to our celebratory date, we're going to be highlighting a lot of those individuals, yes. Rather all of them.
I think as many as we can.
Now, as we celebrate, Commander, is there any room for improvement? I mean, we celebrate good news, but do we have any room for improvement,
yes,
to make this St. Lucia Cadet Corps, let's say,
yes, we
a
do.
Better organization?
Yes, we do. It starts with, and I know there'll be a lot of backlash to it, it speaks of the commitment of our cadet officers. In order for us to move forward, the cadet officers have to show a lot more dedication. I know it's calling on a lot of their personal time and effort given into it. The only way we can achieve the goal of giving the cadets that ultimate cadet experience, and I'm not saying go back to what I did years ago. Some of it, I did what I did at the time, but we have moved. Of the commitment of our officers who will guide, shape, instruct, nurture the young boys and girls who come through the walls of the St. Lucia Cadet Corps, through the schools or whichever avenue you use at any one point in time. It's heavy on the officers. Without them, we're not going to achieve that goal. So this is another call out to all of our officers, active and inactive, to indicate your willingness to assist the children of this island who we help shape. And just a little digress, we have cadets, like I said, in all facets of society, police, fire, Port Authority, the prisons, the ministry, you go up and down, and when you meet and you have quick discussions, one will tell you, I was a cadet.
Yeah.
And you see where this person is within the society itself, within the government and private sector. And you say, yes, that they went through the walls and did some of the same things you did.
Yeah, but I'll tell you that, Commander, like, and you don't mind if I call you Commander, just, you know, short for what I'll call you every day when we speak to each other. I had a long chat with our past commandant, Major Glass, last evening, and we reflect a little bit. And I don't, you said you don't want people to do things like we did it in the past, but that is what made us, you know, who we are today. And we are beginning to lower the bar, yes, gradually. And we have to be very careful not lowering that bar too low, you know, because we're going to lose what it really means to be a true cadet. So I just wanted to mention that.
No, but if I may on that, the reason why I said it's a bit of a paradigm shift, the military institutions along the world, and I'm fortunate to having gone to military school, Fort Leonard Wood in Missouri. I did the full officer course, thankful for that. So I understand better the aspects of military life as an officer. That even recruitment now, the British Army and others are putting it out, that what happened during the recruitment phase has been it's not watered down, it's shifted differently. No longer will you see down the throat of your drill instructor when you come through. So a few things have changed in that regard, but not the ethos of what we want to do. We're still going to be hard when it pertains to weapons and other aspects of the adventurous training, the fieldcraft and others, but there are certain aspects of it where the delivery of the service is not going to change. Maybe as hard as stone, hard as nails, and persons who know. Reason why I'm saying that, we have cadets who come in to the Corps, spend one recruitment period and leave because they perceive it is too hard, too difficult. I'm not in that. On leaving school, come back to the Cadet Corps because the intent is to join the British Army or the U.S. military.
Yes,
and they want a recommendation yeah, and want you to affix a signature with some nice words, whereas some of these persons did not serve honorably at recruitment. It's a phase you go through. It's coming out from on the road and having this paramilitary life. And you spoke about it in the intro, that how the cadets came into being.
Yeah.
So it is not like some of the other social groups we have. It's a paramilitary institution where you do what you are told and you complain thereafter. Oh. And the reason why I said the paradigm shift and some of the things we did before, some of what we did, I'm known as a cane. I have caned almost every cadet who has come through, and at the time maybe that was warranted because of my belief in strict corporal punishment in that regard. I don't see us going on that road now because of the issues it may bring forward. That's something as a slight paradigm shift.
Yes. Throughout this show, ladies and gentlemen, we have a lot of congratulatory messages thrown your way. While we get into the mainstream of the 95th anniversary, I would like us to listen to a message from an old friend of mine. We met at a Caribbean summer camp in Denry, long time ago. Colonel Edison Isaac sent a very nice message to us. I'm hoping that we can just play this right now for you. On the occasion of the 95th anniversary of the St. Lucia Cadet Corps, I take the opportunity to congratulate the commandant, officers, and other ranks on reaching this historic milestone. It is a tribute to all who kept the faith, for to whom much is given, much is expected. In this regard, to be entrusted with the responsibility of nurturing the youth of any country is a task not to be taken lightly. The Corps has, over the years, produced persons who have contributed nationally, regionally, and indeed internationally. Sincere congratulations as you move to your 100th anniversary. To God be the glory. From Colonel Edison Isaac, HBM, CCM, Trinidad and Tobago. Thank you very much. Now, I played that just because of what you said there, the dedication to duty, you know, and we need to get back into that. Yes. You know, there's a lot you give, but there's also a lot you can get back. And most of us who are where we are today, as I discussed with the commandant, it's because of the St. Lucia Cadet Corps. And we need to, you know, and throughout the night, we're going to listen to a few more tributes where people can reflect on the Cadet Corps contribution. But, sir, you are here in the capacity of the chairperson of the 95th anniversary celebrations. Tell us a little bit about what we're in for in St. Lucia, and, you know, to all our cadet friends all around the world, what are we in for our 95th anniversary?
The committee met and we had a lot of discussions as to where we're going to go forward. Are we going to, on the 13th of July, cement our 95th anniversary or start the celebration going there forward? The jury is still out on how we do that. As of the 13th of July, we're going to be 95 years old. We have ongoing items at a theme and logo competition, a national drill competition. We have a possible cross-country walk, the customary anniversary dinner, anniversary parade. We have you, Major Soldibus, launching the coffee table book or magazine.
That's going well.
We have, the highlights of it is the presentation of commemorative medals and lapel pins. Colonel Isaac was one who said, nobody is going to recognize and see you as you do. So the intent of our 95th anniversary, to let St. Lucia and the world know we are alive and well. Our last two commanding officers parades, we saw large numbers of cadets. The intent is at the closing parade of our annual summer camp in Soufre, we have numbers to coincide with our 95th anniversary. We want to show that we are alive and well, not during the times of like the UNEX exercise or the hurricane season that we come out and do this as we did for COVID and other activities. But we want to plant that flag and say for 95 years the St. Lucia Cadet Corps is alive and well. We have transitioned and transformed. We now have the process of going through a newly launched Sea Cadet unit under the charge of Lieutenant Commander Robert Thomas. It is new. At one time, when we remember when females were brought into the entity or re-brought in on a grand scale, Theodore Peters, we had this fight with Lieutenant Colonel Matre and Major Alvin James. We had fights all along, not bringing the females into what we're doing. So we have transitioned over the years. The whole lead towards our 95th anniversary, we are here. We're not going anywhere for another 95 years or looking towards our 100th anniversary. The St. Lucia Cadet Corps is alive and well.
Good, 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 good. How celebrating 95 is one big thing, but as a couple of my friends said, and as you heard Colonel Isaac was saying, you know, getting ready for the 100th anniversary. What I did tell the commandant last show that, hey, we're not going into the 100th, but you being the chair, though, of the 95th anniversary, what do you see us doing to really celebrate 100 years on the eve? And I can call it the eve. 5 years is just, you know, five years away.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
What are you planning for this big 100th anniversary?
My vision, or my bringing forward to the executive, thanks to the government of St. Lucia, we now have Cadet Headquarters, which is at the old Ectel building, close to Beachcomber. I see us unveiling the new Cadet Headquarters, having as many cadets and a few youth groups, including foreign contingents, to the countries we have been with all along. Barbados, St. Vincent, Trinidad, Jamaica, St. Kitts, at least a small contingent coming down to St. Lucia at our new cadet headquarters, new parade square, new grounds for our 100th anniversary.
We're looking at the time frame. What time frame we are talking about? And I was told I made a mistake last time, and I said, I think I used the word either y'all or, and it was not, and as if I was not including myself.
Yeah,
and I was almost charged for that.
And rightfully so.
You know, one of my friends told me, you know, I have to pay up for that. What's the time frame in getting the headquarters up and running, getting the parade square up and running for full use by the St. Lucia Cadet Corps?
We have been discussions with the government, with the senior minister, Stevenson King, and I to you, sir. And he's having these discussions with our adjutant and our staff officer, Major Ainsworth Shalmine, who works with the Ministry of Infrastructure, and our adjutant, Major Sean Wells. The discussions are going where we have a few quotes in from private contractors, and we see it how best we can come to Corporate St. Lucia with a plan. The plan is being developed at this point in time to what we are going to do with Cadet Headquarters. The commandant's view, as well as Cadet Headquarters, to manage the property, to have an office or have space where one or two of the youth entities can share the space with us.
Good.
That is so. Whereas the cadets, we have numbers and we would be custodians of it. Have a space where we can do joint activities. The intent is to work on an obstacle course, a parade square, a particular portion of the grounds as a campsite, so we can teach the cadets camp craft, adventurous training. And that could be used as well. You don't see too much of the guides or the other groups, but the pack, whoever is there in that capacity as a uniform group, could put in an application to how so we don't have activities going on while they are there.
Right. Commander, I mentioned last show that we have a wonderful relationship with our ministry, our minister, our head of state, but you're very close to our head of state.
Yes.
And we've, as you know, as it goes right now, we've never had such a close relationship with our line minister, with our, what I call the commander-in-chief,
yes.
You know. Tell us a little bit about that relationship. Ours with our His Governor-General, His Excellency.
His Excellency, Errol Charles. I can say, personal reach is a call away.
Yeah.
Excellency, if you are not too busy, you'd want to have some frank discussions with you on whatever matter. He would say, he would either check his diary or I will get back to you. And His Excellency calls back. If he has any questions, queries, he would call in. And it's just a matter of the availability. When His Excellency calls, you make the time to see him.
Yes.
We had a similar one with the Impulekwizi. Her mandate was different and how she operated different. But with His Excellency Errol Charles, he has the cadet caught at. I see no issues with it now. As a matter of fact, we owe him right now. We should have had a parade with all of His Excellency's officers at Government House. We had a few issues with uniforms and persons being properly outfitted. And it's insubordination to fall in a group of officers, commissioned and intended commission officers, present them to His Excellency when persons are not properly clad. Everything we have on comes at a cost.
Yeah.
And they're a little difficult times. So we are waiting when we have sufficiently clothed officers to have this parade with His Excellency so he can see his officers who he is Commander-in-Chief to.
Good.
So that is ongoing. So like I say, again, His Excellency Errol Charles, excellent relationship.
Very nice.
I will get spoken to tomorrow for bringing that up. But His Excellency has been very supportive in all we are doing. He has given us guidance in other matters. He's said what he wants to see us more involved in, what he would like to see us do. It's unfortunate that he cannot fund some of the activities that we want. But once available...
But he's there for us.
He's there. Government House.
That is good.
It's good for us.
That is good. Ladies and gentlemen, as I said throughout the show, we're going to be showing a few congratulatory messages. But now, later down, just before the end, I would like to open the lines so cadets can call in because we have a trivia question. And the prize for that question is a wonderful birthday cake. Whoever wins, and when your birthday is coming up, you get a beautiful birthday cake, all sponsored by a member of the very first female, all-female platoon in the St. Lucia Cadet Corps, the Viewfort Comprehensive School, Esther Bryce from Tats Cakes. Okay, the question is, who took command of the St. Lucia Cadet Corps after the resignation of Major Roger Eudoxie? So
can when I
we
answer?
No. So when you open the lines later, you know, cadets can call in, or anybody can call in, and more so cadets, of course, to try and get that cake. We had a message last time from retired adjutant Captain Romeo Michelle, and I really could. We didn't have the time to answer. One of them you answered already. First of all, you would like to say congratulations on securing the St. Lucia Cadet Corps headquarters. And the first question was, how do you see this benefiting the St. Lucia and youth leadership as a whole, and you answered that question mm-hmm. a while ago, so I don't want to. But his third question was, I recognize that the adult cadre of the St. Lucia Cadet Corps are all volunteers. How do we, you know, create incentive for those adult officers in ensuring that they contribute to the growth and demonstrate a good discipline, decorum, and leadership by example in the Cadet Corps? I know we have volunteers, but okay. How do you create the incentive an officer cadre knowing that we give so much?
I am looking forward to that formula as well. I mean, you're an officer and you know the cost of everything we do. I don't know. Voluntarism is dying in St. Lucia. Contrary to what other people think, voluntarism is dying. Whereas you do want to say it's a payment, a stipend. Some of the other countries have a stipend for the cadet officers, and they coin it in a way for laundry and polish and all, but laundry isn't polish, not cheap anymore. But something to assist the officers, because the officers push their hands in their pockets almost daily to assist the cadets. So whereas it's not a salary, a stipend to help along. So not all of our officers are mobile in the point that they go and have to find themselves at every cadet activity once they are being directed or so informed of it. Mm-hmm. So some form of, I would say, monetary contribution or incentive in that regard to pay for transport.
Yeah. Well, in Turks and Caicos, I mean, the cadet officers yes. are well paid, the commandant is well paid.
It's a job.
The job, it was opened last year.
Yes.
You know, I almost applied because it the is. Staff. So who knows, that may convince the government one day into creating a stipend for cadet officers.
It's not a stipend. Let us see how best we can assist the officers in basics. I want to say this on record. We want to thank Nemo, the director now, Kenisha Jeffrey Isenbert, to have allowed us to carry on using a portion of the Nemo headquarters as cadet headquarters, where we assist in other matters of state and disaster preparedness and readiness. But it is a symbiotic relationship we have. We have officers and parents coming out. This time going forward, we have more parental involvement than ever before. First and second battalions, kudos to the commander, the battalion commanders, Major Ernesto Emmanuel, who is commanding in transition, to Captain Winsbert Pierre-Louis, and Captain Peter Jean-Baptiste in 2nd Battalion.
Yeah.
3rd Battalion, Major Dylan St. Jules. So I'm saying that we have a lot to be happy of.
Yes.
We have moved full but the mission, and just a quick segue, 1st Battalion, all school units in the north of the island, 2nd Battalion, south of the island, 3rd Battalion, our Service Support Battalion, which is supposed to render support with communications, messing, engineering, and all other aspects that are not within the gamut of the school units.
Yes.
That the Service Support Battalion
does. Good, thank you. Should know about is what is the structure of the Cadet Corps and how does it function. When we come back, because right now I want to play a few more messages from cadets.
I am Curtis Roberts, former warrant officer in the St. Lucia Cadet Corps. This organization has always kept its focus on discipline, leadership, and service while building character in our young men and women here in St. Lucia, with, of course, myself being no exception. Currently, I am an assistant superintendent of police in the Royal St. Lucia Police Force, and I can boast that the St. Lucia Cadet Corps, in part, was responsible and instrumental in shaping me to start my career. If I were to mention my greatest takeaways, they would be my lessons in leadership and teamwork. I would like to congratulate the St. Lucia Cadet Corps on their observance of 95 years of existence and encourage them to continue the great job that they are doing in shaping our young men and women into model citizens.
I would like to take this opportunity to thank the St. Lucia Cadet Corps for having me through the ranks over the years. As we celebrate 95 years of existence, pure perfection, discipline, and a lot of things that contribute to positive outcome in today's society. As the commander of the Marine Unit from 2021 until my retirement, I think it's only fitting that I highlight the importance of the discipline, the courage, the bravery, that was instilled in me through the St. Lucia Cadet Corps. The many years of service and the many engagements throughout the years until my recruitment into the Royal St. Lucia Police Force. So once again, thank you very much to the St. Lucia Cadet Corps for the impact on my life.
Thank you very much. We have a few more to come. I actually said overseas. Those were local guys. Those were our local guys. But we have a few wonderful ones from all over. And we're going to talk about it a little later. The structure of the St. Lucia Cadet Corps, normally the ministry have a structure, the minister, permanent secretary, the scouts have one. Tell us a little bit, or tell rather the public a little bit about what is the structure of the St. Lucia Cadet Corps. How does it function?
We have the commandant, Colonel Nathan Hyacinth. We have me as a deputy commandant. We have the adjutant, Major Sean Wells, staff officer, Major Ainsworth Charlemagne. We have our legal officer, Captain Ramon Ravino. We have our finance officer, Captain Anthony Alley. Then we break it down into the battalions. And I gave the battalion structure a while ago, how it goes on with service support. We have persons like Captain Elise, our PR officer. I don't want to miss out on anybody in that regard. But we do have a structure that indicates where officers are placed. The St. Lucia Cadet Corps is not an entity which has floating officers. Officers have to be assigned. Floating is not the way forward for the entity. In order to guide, direct, and instruct the cadets within the battalions, which now has the company. So you have a battalion structure, which is the overall management for the in the north. You have like Alpha, Charlie, Bravo, Delta, under Delta, St. Joseph's Convent. You have Comprehensive School. You have Corinth, Charles. It's broken down that way for the management of it. And the officers now operate as company commanders, which is the manager for two or three schools under your command. And each school has a unit officer.
Okay. I'm a principal and I want to get some information about cadet and who runs the day-to-day affairs. Let the public know. The adjutant.
Major Sean Wells, ably assisted by the entire executive with the day-to-day operations of how cadet headquarters works. And he's a volunteer as well.
Right. And we have a training wing headed by a training officer.
Major Trevor Alfred, who has a short leave of absence. That has been doubled up by Major Ainsworth, who's taken up the role of executive training officer in the absence of Major. I didn't bring the exact structure with me. I don't want to leave out any of the officers and persons who I may not have called in by name. My apologies. Oh, I want to mention as well, SOAS officer. Captain Fede. So we have officers who step up to the plate. That is from the headquarters side of things. So you have broken down into the command element. You have the 1st, 2nd, and 3rd battalions. Then you have your storeroom. You have your messing. You don't want to forget person like Cassius. Machine, Captain.
Yes.
So no, I'm just pulling out names at random of persons who come in and who have been around and have assisted. Have a mandate to bring forward. The emphasis right now are on the three battalions. 1st battalion, all schools north of the island, between Major Ernesto Emmanuel and Captain Winsbert Pierre-Louis. 2nd battalion, Major Jabatis, ably assisted by a few officers. And the problem we have, some officers have transitioned into other aspects of work and life, and they don't have that time availability to carry on going forward. So this is a call now for the other officers who are not stationed or not posted to come forward, have a discussion with the staff officer and the adjutant for placement. The cadets are waiting to be taught, to be guided, to be shown what has to be done, carrying on with the ethos of our 95th anniversary. And that brings into mind, there's a short pushing in, that our theme and logo competition, we have a few entrants or persons who have sent in the logos, and the intent is that going forward for the year of celebration, the cadet or the applicant with the best logo competition, the best logo for the 95th anniversary, will receive a nice prize. That logo will be entire year, anything the Cadet Corps is doing, that look will go. I know you have a submission.
No, I'm laughing because I have submitted. Commander, you spoke about parents a while ago.
Yes.
During my time, parents were off limits.
Yes.
Right? And we, you know, your parents just say goodbye to you at the gate and that's it. And wash your clothes when you come back and make sure you're well fed, because sometimes we go out there for a long time. Attending the last Commander's Parade, I saw parents in uniform.
Yes.
And they really, there's a nice synergy. Tell us a little bit more about the benefits of the parents right now, and how is that?
Dress uniform. It's not a cadet uniform, but the parents within battalions. It started with 2nd Battalion and the Major Jabatis. They have a very active parents group.
Good.
That assists 1st Battalion, followed up to what 2nd Battalion is doing. When we have camps, we are most times our own cooks. And you can hear some of the horror stories. That has changed. Call any of the parents in the 1st Battalion grouping, assisted. And there's a cake sale which is due up next over the weekend, handled by 1st Battalion. And you see the parents are involved. What we would do, doing the cooking, the baking and all, the parents are stood up for the Commander's Parade, which was held at Nemo under strange weather condition. The 1st Battalion parents group came up and they assisted in catering. They took charge of it. It's something that we have not had before. That is why some of our activities have changed a lot more, and we speak to our officers of how they deal with the cadets. Not because the presence of the parents are there, because you wouldn't ignore a cadet in the presence of the parent.
Yeah.
Being absent or present, you do what you have to do, but respectfully. Parents have helped out an enormous bit of assistance in both 1st and 2nd Battalion, where they help chart the way forward. I'm down in Beaufort 2nd Battalion with Major. The parents take shifts and they ensure that they in at PT time to ensure breakfast is on time.
Yeah, good stuff.
Lunch is on time.
Good stuff.
They do not interfere with the daily runnings of the cadet activities. If an unsafe activity is going on and the parent is around, they will speak to the senior person on ground. But the parents do not come and get involved in the training of the cadets. And if they are doing it, stop it now, parents. That is not your mandate.
Yes, we have. Thanks for that. And so more parents should come on board.
Yes,
because it's a nice thing, and the students feel more comfortable. You know, parents are right there.
But we have parents on our anniversary committee as well.
Good. We yes, I met some of them. Yes.
Parents.
Yes. So as promised, we're gonna view another video of some of our ex-cadets sending congratulatory messages. And then we're going to move into a photograph I found in my archives, and I want to question Lieutenant Commander Lake about it. To our videos.
The purpose of drill is to produce a cadet who is proud, obedient, and alert. It also provides a basis for good teamwork. Today, standing on this premise, I take this opportunity to wish this great establishment a happy, happy, happy 95th anniversary. As part of the alumni of this great organization, I can truly say that the Cadet Corps was instrumental in my personal growth and formation. I have learned and grown to appreciate the value of community service, the value of teamwork, and to be disciplined in everything that I do in life. As the Cadet Corps continue to nurture young minds and to instill that discipline in our youth of St. Lucia and to make a difference in our society, I am proud to have been, to still be connected with the St. Lucia Cadet Corps. So from my heart to all of our fellow cadets, those serving now, those who have served, and those who have gone before us, I wish you a happy 95th. May God bless you. May God continue to enrich the hearts and minds of the leaders of this organization, that we will bring St. Lucia, our beautiful nation, to a place which is full of love, harmony, unity, and togetherness. Wishing you once again from the beautiful sunny island of Turks and Caicos, to the Cadet Corps of St. Lucia. Happy 95.
As a former cadet, I am very happy to be provided with an opportunity to say thank you. The Corps provided a space to be part of something unimaginable, a setting that is bigger than each individual member, the space to learn leadership skills and to exemplify a commitment to service, hard work, and a winning attitude that has opened doors for its members. Sending a big high five your way on your 95th, the country owes you a depth of gratitude for grooming leaders. There's a lot to be proud of. Here's to continued success. I can't wait to see the amazing things to come.
Thank you very much. I mean, I got a cold chill just listening to Beth.
Beth.
We call her Beth.
Beth Atkins.
Yeah, very nice. And that was Lisa in New York. So I don't know. Right now we can put the number on the screen because we just, you know, into our final 5 minutes. So you can call. And let me just remind you.
I want to make two corrections.
Yes.
Go to WhatsApp.
Yeah, let me just give them the question quickly. Who took command of the St. Lucia Cadet Corps after the resignation of Major Roger Eudoxie? So the number will be on the screen in a while. And you can call in. No, go ahead. You wanted to make correction. A correction?
I may have said Captain Jabatiste, the battalion commander for 2nd Battalion, it's Major
Jabatiste. Major Jabatiste.
Major Jabatiste. Yes. I know why you said that.
Yes,
and our PR officer, Captain Elize. The other officers at a subsequent broadcast, I will have the opportunity of showing St. Lucia, or somebody will show St. Lucia, the entire structure.
Yeah.
And what the structure of the Central Cadet Corps looks like, moving into from company formation into battalion structure in going forward.
Good. Just in case you don't see that number, it's 4533-911. Call in, answer the question, and that wonderful cake is yours. We have a photograph, and I found this in my archives, and I want to end the show with us inspiring young minds, you know, into this Ninja Cadet Corps by just talking a little bit about this photograph. Let me see this photograph and let Lieutenant Commander Lake, you know, Lieutenant Colonel, talk about that. First of all, who are the guys in there?
On the left, Dr. Thomas Sylvester Samuel. Next to him, Major Dylan St. Jules, Sergeant Chris Mathias, Perry Thomas, and extreme end, Boogie.
Yes, Ricky Etienne.
Ricky Etienne.
Yes, my dear brother.
Inspector Ricky Etienne.
Yes. And if you look at where they are today, well placed in our society, you know, reputable
but
men of
the century. Look at it now. Look at the transformation. Samuel with a yellow and black belt, which we still wear to this day.
Yeah.
The white belt that Dylan wears is no longer in operation. The two other sets of belts are okay. The red sashes have been changed into a green sash. So we have transitioned a bit from what happened in the time with our reign into having it more St. Lucian with green sashes. That's a blasphemy.
Dr. Samuel is wearing something on his wrist. Just tell the public what position he's holding there right now.
He's a CSM, and that is the crown.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
The crown is worn on the right hand. To this day, I still wear my watch on my right hand, having been down that road as well.
I can just remember not wanting to part with that rank.
No.
I was really, really hesitant to accept my promotion going forward because this is a lovely, lovely rank, power in your hands.
You're not the only one. I mean,
you would boast
that you would be the longest serving warrant officer until you made an officer.
But let's see that other photograph, though, and the one we really want to talk about. Yes. Now, I want some names, and I want the young cadets to sink into that. I want some names here. I see one officer in uniform with a sword. I see yourself holding the national flag, you know, the pay stick, another little black bag. I don't know what's in there. But tell us about the people in there and what's going on.
Okay, the one with his back to us is Staff Sergeant Dylan St. Jules. That's me here. Next to me is retired Lieutenant Colonel Andre Matre. Next to him, the blue shirt, Patrick Amerson Edwards, recently deceased. Next to him, the yellow shirt, Francis Reynolds, aka Buddy. Next to him, Kurt Thomas, who works with the AG's office. Standing next to him, Alvin James, retired major, and Mafias Wilkie. In uniform is Chris Markey a one-type feared regimental sergeant major.
Yep. What's happening there in that photograph?
That is not that is VG Airport.
Not George Charles.
Not George. George Charles. No. George Charles don't even know what happened there. That is VG Airport with Markey heading a delegation. I think they're going to send kits. And I had was given the honor of carrying the pay stick, the national flag, and that, I wouldn't say what's in the bag, but that is actually the support we had when any contingent was traveling out of St. Lucia, that everybody came in to bid farewell to the team traveling. That's a real blast from the past.
There is a real legacy when you hear family names like Markey mm-hmm. in the St. Lucia Cadet Corps. Mm-hmm. Let the young cadets, you know, what tell them a little bit about that.
Chris Markey was one of our most feared regimental sergeant majors. He had a way of dispelling discipline or instilling discipline. A no-nonsense person. With honor, he served until he was promoted. Mm-hmm. I think he handed over to Eddie Hazel. But Chris Markey was one of our most feared regimental sergeant majors. I'm old enough now to stand up, and if I see him, tell him what I will tell him, which I could not have done at the time.
Yeah.
Or never thought of it.
Just looking at that photograph, I must admit, what I would like to see one day, and I hope, I think the commandant is already, you know, in trying to plan that, is for us to have a wall of fame one day, or yes. a library where people can come in and look at those photographs of ex-cadets and the stories behind them, because they've done a lot for St. Lucia. They've served a lot. They've yes. volunteered a lot. I mean, there's a commandant in that photograph, an ex-commandant.
Yeah,
I mean, yeah, you there's just a lot going on there. Two of them, right.
Matre and Major Alvin Jameswood. The PR officer, and I'm calling out on him now, Captain Cyril Elize, has been charged with responsibility of putting up at cadet headquarters the photographs of commandants, and he has had help with Don French and other persons in getting the names and photographs of some of these
persons. I recently bought that book written yes. by Don French, yes.
And our PR officer, Captain Elize, calling you out, you will cry about it later, but he's lacking in getting it done, and he has a mandate to have our Hall of Fame at our headquarters.
Okay, good stuff. We've not had any calls, so I suppose nobody wants that cake, but the question
if I can answer, will I get a cake?
You have a call? Yes, go ahead.
Hello, good evening.
Good evening.
Let me say good evening to my brothers in the cadet hood. I want to say happy birthday to us. And I just want to say, just like all cadets would say, that my home of discipline, my manhood came from my life in the cadet corps. And I want to wish all the new cadets, all the new leaders well, and continue doing our best so that we can keep young people in place. But I have to ask for one favor of the leadership of the cadet corps. I was one of the first set of cadets who went into Barbados after independence. And when we returned, most of us were given ranks that were never, ever ratified. I would like the leadership, new leadership find us out and ratify us. I want to die with my cadet rank.
What is your name, sir?
Second Lieutenant Soldier.
I was asking.
What is your name, sir?
Second Lieutenant Soldier.
That is Second Lieutenant Saltibus. Yeah, that is my brother, Second Lieutenant Saltibus, who actually, when I asked you the question earlier, what inspired you to become a cadet, is because I used to actually go to the Viewfort Comprehensive School and just observe my brother and then my sister marching there, and from early days, I think I became a cadet even before I was enrolled, right in the cadet corps. So yes, that is my brother, Second Lieutenant Hilary Saltibus.
And on behalf of my daughter, who also went through the cadet corps and brought her into the British Army, I want to say thank you. continue guiding the leadership, and I want to be able to get into the cadet corps now. But I encourage parents that once your kid gets into secondary school, give them the discipline that the cadet corps can give them. My cadet brothers, have a blessed night, and you all have done a perfect and positive job tonight.
Thank you very much.
And good night.
Thank you very much. Deputy Commander, that has come up before. And we do have people like Captain Quinlan,
yes.
Willibald Charles,
Sekunda.
A lot of those persons who we know served with honor. And to date, I mean, I remember when I went through some of the cadet files, you know, with my tour of duty at Government House, you see their names there. And you see a general letter with the head of state signing at the bottom, giving them the authority and the rank, but they don't have the instruments.
Okay.
And I think we should really pursue that, you know, going forward, you know, putting in a good case with the Governor General to issue them, you know, their instruments.
Since they are ready,
so they can post on their wall and say, I was really a cadet during that period. I think that is...
We'll have to have discussions with His Excellency and see how we could bridge that gap.
I see. So I don't know if we have any other calls, but I think it is... Yes, we have one. Go ahead. I hope you can answer that question.
Hello, good night.
Good night.
Hi, how are you doing? This is Captain James, yeah?
Captain James.
Which James?
I have to call. I felt the James.
Okay, sir.
I've been following the last show and this show, and I can say that it is very informative, and I would love to see that show could go more than the allotted time. Because I know some persons would love to call and have a good conversation with you guys. Understand? And if there are any parents listening, I would love to tell you parents that the Cadet Corps is the best place where your child can be at this time. With the advent of all those criminal activities and those peer pressures out there, the Cadet Corps is the best place to be in at this time. So your child can be the best that they can be. The core is about leadership, service, and discipline. And this is what we instill in the cadets. And as they go from point to point, from during the childhood into adulthood, variants come in, and you can never tell what will happen later on in life. But for now, let us try and give the cadets, give your child the strength, the encouragement to join the cadet corps. Because I was even having a conversation with a principal, a vice principal of a primary school, where she was saying that it would be good if the cadet corps can come in and have a talk with the grade 6 students, so as to give them a feel of the cadet corps. So when they transcend into the secondary schools, they would already have the interest. And whatever it is that you do, so when they go, we'll have to go search for them again. They're already there because they want to be part of it. So it's like she said, she wants us to come there in our various uniforms so that the kids can see it, so they can pick their interests. So when they come across these secondary schools, you know, they're already there. We don't have to go search for them again. You understand?
Thanks again. Thanks for that.
Good idea.
Thanks for that, Captain James.
Thanks for that, Captain James. We're really running out of time.
But the question is not for you to answer. I don't know if you'll get it right or wrong, but the question was not for you to answer, Captain James.
So we're going to try and wrap up. I don't know if we can take one last call if we're permitted to get to a young cadet to answer the question who took command of the Saint Lucia Cadet Corps. Designation of Major Roger Eudoxie. We have a call. Go ahead. Hello?
Hello, good evening.
Good evening.
Is it Mr. Andre Mathre?
I don't know, you tell me.
Well, Mr. Andre Mathre.
No. After Roger Eudoxie, no.
No.
Okay then, thank you.
Thanks for the try.
All right.
That means you're paying attention somewhere.
Yes. Okay. Well, we're going to allow them to call anyway, but we're out of time right now, but you can still call and give the answer. But Lieutenant Commander, Deputy Commander of the Saint-Lucia Cadet Corps, your closing remarks to inspire young boys and girls to become members of the Saint-Lucia Cadet Corps.
Band of brothers, and I use the term brothers as brothers and sisters. You can get no closer tie
than being a member of the St. Lucia Cadet Corps. You will have stories, children, and I'm not even talking about the other school groupings. There are things you will do with the cadets that you will not normally do with any other entity on the island. I've been going through to this. I'm saying, try it out. Nothing in life is easy. The St. Lucia Cadet Corps is not like some of the other social groups. At some point in time, you will be doing weapon training, so you understand the level of discipline and strict behavior that is required of you. We have a call?
We do have a call. Caller, go ahead.
We do have a call. I'm Corporal Mattelli Mandy, and the answer is Major Kitty's Glass.
That is correct.
That is correct, and you really you hit the nail there. Yep, Mr. Curtis Glass, and as I was telling you last night, wrap up a little bit on what you were saying.
You have to get the number.
I had a conversation with him last night, and it lasted close to an hour. And the stories we were telling to each other, I wish I can fly to Antigua where he's at and start writing a book. You know, because they are good stories of leadership, you know, of mentoring young boys and girls. So this was just phenomenal. Can you give us your number?
285-7581.
That means she paid attention to military knowledge class.
You paid attention. And when is your birthday?
August 18th.
Oh, you're just in time. Okay, well, we'll get in touch, and trust me, you're going to get a wonderful cake, because at Tats Cakes, we do produce some of the best cakes on island. So, you know, throwing a pin there in for my sister. Yes. So, thank you very much, caller.
Thank you, Major.
We're out of time, and I want to thank you for being my guest this evening. I want us to spread the word to every parent, every principal, every teacher, every young cadet. Next week, Wednesday, same time, 8:30. And we're going to have, I'm trying to get a parent and a cadet to actually come on set, so they can tell you about their experiences in the St. Lucia Cadet Corps and how we move forward, how the recruitment. I also threw out a challenge to cadets for this weekend. I know some of you are at camp, and some of you have a drill competition going along. So I want you to record yourself, you know, a day in the life of a cadet. When you get up, videotape yourself, have your brother, your sister hold your phone for you, get dressed, move out, go on the parade square, do what you have to do, and submit it to your regimental sergeant major. She will then pass it on to us, and we're going to choose the best five and air it for the whole world to see what you know, what a perfect day in the life of a cadet is. And you know, we're going to have those activities throughout until the 13th of July. Commander, as I did for the commandant of the St. Lucia Cadet Corps, I will allow you the closing remarks.
St. Lucia, 95 years of existence of one entity, which is still going strong today, shows the resilience and the ability for us to carry on. The St. Lucia Cadet Corps has had its challenges along the pathway going forward. As compared to complaining and staying along the sidelines, give your opportunity to see what they're really made of. I can assure you, you'll have a changed child at the end of the period, to some positive, to some not so positive. As the officer responsible for discipline within the St. Lucia Cadet Corps, the transition from strict corporal punishment into somewhat trials will tell that persons who run amok where the kids are concerned will be dealt with. This is an opportunity to carry on the mandate by the Minister of Education, Honorable Sean Edward, to increase our numbers. We can augment, or we have augmented the Royal Central Police Force, which I and some of the other persons who spoke were members of, the Central Fire Service, the Prison Service, Port Authority. We have cadets who are EMTs who assist. I'm saying that the list is ongoing. Give your child an opportunity to become a good citizen, that when you walk down the road, persons would say, a cadet, because you more or less march as compared to walking. Some of the attributes on how you go around if your workplace, persons will see a difference in your child. Give them an opportunity. Let us help bring forward better citizens in St. Lucia. Thank you.
Thank you very much. This was Celebrating 95. We are going into a program that is mandatory and we have no time. Thanks a lot for watching. See you next week.